Right, good morning, everyone. Welcome to a new day. Let's begin this time with a word of prayer. Sri Kumar, can you please lead us in prayer?
Yes, Pastor.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Precious Father, we thank you and praise you for this wonderful morning which you have given to us. We surrender ourselves before you, God, Master. We pray that, Father, prepare our heart in the name of Jesus, and we pray that, Father, every word which is we are going to receive from your servant's mouth, let it be directly from the throne room of God, Master. Fill him with your wisdom and revelation and knowledge and insight. And Father God, every heart, O Lord Father, going to hear and receive it, O Father, let it be a blessing so that we can stand strong, O Lord Master, for your kingdom and for your glory. We give you all the glory, honor, and praises, O Father God, to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Sri Kumar.
Thank you, Pastor.
All right. So yesterday we completed chapter 6. We'll get into chapter 7 this morning. Now, before I go ahead, I just wanted to keep us informed that we've got a lot more to cover. So there will be, we will not read every verse. This is going to take too much time, but what we'll do is we'll try to bring out the essence of the entire chapter. So we'll move a little fast so that we can complete this portion by the end of April, right? But if you have questions in between, let it not stop you. Feel free to ask questions. If you feel I'm going too fast, let me know and I can slow down as well. All right, let's get into chapter 7, innovation and creativity. Now, innovation and creativity is something that every organization needs, right? Whether we are in the marketplace or whether we are in ministry, we need innovation, we need creativity. Whether it is solving problems or coming up with a breakthrough idea, because sometimes we are in this organization and things may just be going on, just the same way. Meaning there's repetitive, monotonous work. And we're not seeing any inspiration, or we're not passionate about what we're doing. So that is why innovation and creativity is very important. The word innovation means to come up with new idea, to innovate. And creativity is, again, coming up with new strategies and new ideas. Right now, the Bible is filled with examples on innovation, creativity. And so let's look at a few points on how our God is a God who gives us the wisdom to come up with innovation and creativity. And he did that in the Old Testament. He did that in the New Testament. And God is the same now. Whether we are in the workplace, in ministry, God can give us ideas on how to, reach out to people, or how to be effective, come up with strategies, ideas. Everything comes from God. Sometimes we feel, okay, this was my idea. But the source is God, right? So let's see what God teaches us in this chapter. Just a few points, and we'll pick up like every chapter. We'll just explain the points as well. God reveals, instructs, and teaches his children, right? So what must we do? Ask him, right? I'm on page 59. God reveals, instructs, and teaches. So let's read Isaiah 28, 23 to 29. Isaiah 28, 23 to 29.
Okay. Pastor, am I audible?
Yes. Go ahead.
Thank you, Pastor. Okay, let's read Isaiah 28, 23 to 29. Listen to what I'm saying. Pay attention to what I am telling you. Farmers don't constantly plow their fields and keep getting there ready for planting. Once they have prepared the soil, they plant the seeds of herbs such as dill and cumin. They plant rows of wheat and barley. And at the edge of their fields, they plant other grain. They know how to do their work because God has taught them. They never use a heavy club or beat out dill seeds or cumin seeds. Instead, they use light sticks of the proper size. They do not ruin the wheat by threshing it endlessly, and they know how to thrash it by driving a cart over it without brushing the grain. All this wisdom comes from the Lord Almighty. The plans God makes are wise, and they always succeed. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Avinash. This is so clear here. In the Old Testament, farming was one of the main occupations of the people, right? But how did they learn it? They didn't just wake up one morning and say, okay, let's put the seeds. No. God, the verse there says, they know how to do their work because God taught them. Right? And towards the end of, in chapter 29, all this wisdom comes from the Lord Almighty. The plans God makes are wise and they always succeed. Now, farming is not ministry. Farming is just farming. It's just regular work. But in the Old Testament, Isaiah is trying to bring out this aspect that everything that we do, he's using the example of farming, but he's trying to bring out the example that all that we do, all the work what we do, it is God who teaches us, right? Who knew that, you know, you dig down into the ground and, you know, you hit a rock and then water is going to come out. God would have given the wisdom to people. And so in whatever we see around us, God knows everything about his creation. And when he knows everything, he knows how to instruct us. He knows, bring innovation, creativity. God does not run out of ideas. We can't say, God, I don't think you may have any more ideas in this field. No. God can bring out many, many innovations, many, many ideas. God is not limited, right? He guides people into the process of discovering it, right? God is wise. He is powerful. He makes and unmakes kings, right? Daniel 2:20. Remember this, Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar has a dream. He wakes up, he's forgotten his dream. And he says, okay, if you don't reveal the dream to me and explain it to me, Daniel, your life is in danger. And Daniel goes back, he prays, God reveals it to him. So he tells King Nebuchadnezzar what his dream was and also explains it to him. So what do we learn from that? God is a revealer of things that are deep, that are secret, that are hidden, right? So what must we do? Since God knows everything, we must ask him, right? Especially in times when we feel that, you know, things are monotonous, your work, ministry at times, right? Especially those in ministry, I would say that, you know, waking up every morning, things could get monotonous. You may feel tired at times. Ask God to give you innovation, to give you ideas, to give you strategies. He knows. We can't say, God, I'm not sure if you know about the city and how things work here. No, he knows all things. He's the creator. He's wise. All wisdom and power belongs to him, right? The point is we have to ask him, right? Two, wisdom is the most important thing. Proverbs chapter 4, 5-9. Let me read that. Get wisdom and insight. Do not forget or ignore what I say. Do not abandon wisdom, and she will protect you. Love her, and she will keep you safe. Getting wisdom is the most important thing you can do. Whatever else you get insight. Love wisdom, and she will make you great. Embrace her, and she will honor you. She will bring on you honor. She will be your crowning glory. Now, Solomon is writing this, and we know that Solomon was a man of great wisdom. When God asked him, what do you want? He said, give me wisdom. And so God was very pleased with what he asked, because wisdom is having insight to the true nature of things, right? For example, we're looking at a situation ahead of us, right? And we don't know how to handle the situation, right? We may have knowledge, but wisdom is looking into the true nature of things. It enables us to make a right decision at the right time, right? Wisdom enables us to have foresight, So for example, you know, if you're looking at 2025, right, looking at maybe your business or your ministry, 2025. So wisdom enables you to have foresight. You look into the future. You say, okay, God, give me the wisdom. What I need to do to look at this ministry in 2025, to see how this business or this ministry can be effective in 2025. To foresee, wisdom is to foresee what things might be like and determine what needs to be done. Right now, in the scriptures, we see that God is the source of all wisdom. Right? God is, you know, he empowers, he provides counsel, he gives us ideas, he brings wealth, he brings glory. Wisdom that can unravel the mysteries hidden in creation, that is what God can reveal to us. Right? Now, here's the thing. We can have a lot of people, right, and I've seen this especially in ministry as well. A lot of people, they have a lot of knowledge, right? They know everything, whether it's the Bible, whether it's a thing in business or in the marketplace. They have a great knowledge. But somewhere along the line, they don't have wisdom. Right? You know, many businessmen who, you know, they're extremely successful in their business, but their marriages are falling apart. Why? It's because you need the wisdom of God to handle both business and family. Right? There's a young boy who came to our church recently, and he was saying, "My father's, you know, very, very well off, very well to do. He doesn't have any problems financially." But he was, when he was sharing, he was saying that his heart yearns for a relationship with his father and his mother. There was no relationship. There was no, love expressed, right? It was not about the toys or the gifts that he got on birthdays and Christmas and all of that. But there was no joy that he felt. And even now he feels that way. Does he have any financial problems? No. But there was no wisdom in dealing with the situation, right? So James, in the book of James, James writes so wonderfully. He says, "But if any of you lack wisdom, you should pray to God, who will give it to you, because God gives generously and graciously to all." Here's the thing. Sometimes people say wisdom comes by age. I agree and I disagree, because wisdom also comes through experience. You can be 25 years old, gone through a lot of challenges, but walk in great wisdom. Right? But you can be a 60-year-old, gone through many things, and walk in foolishness too. So not always wisdom comes by age, but God is the source of wisdom. When we ask him, he gives it to us. Right? So in our work, in our ministry, welcome the spirit of wisdom to anoint us. Right? When, for example, you are preparing for the class, right? You're getting ready. Spend a couple of minutes, maybe 10 or 15 minutes before the class. Say, "Holy Spirit, give me the wisdom to understand. Give me the wisdom to take the word and apply it in my life." So what are we doing? We're welcoming the spirit of wisdom to anoint us, right? Isaiah 11:12 says, "The spirit of the Lord shall rest upon you, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord." I remember, when I was in Bible college, I would wait for the classes to start. So I didn't like Saturdays. I didn't want Saturdays to come because I'm so interested. I just wanted to learn. And I would go back to the scriptures. I would read. I would try to understand. Some of it didn't make sense at all. I'd be wondering, what do I do? And then I was really interested in revelations and studying these prophets of the Old Testament, but it was too much. But I remember just spending a lot of time and asking God, God, without your wisdom, I cannot handle this. The Lord began to give me strategies, give me ideas, right? How to study the Bible. Because I was just randomly open and then read. But the Lord gave me ideas. Give me the wisdom. He said, okay, you divide. So for, just giving you an example, Old Testament. Now there's so many kings, so many prophets, all of this. So God gave me an idea. He said, okay, divide the nation of Israel into two. We see the northern kingdom, southern kingdom. So you divide it. You write down the kings in the northern kingdom, write down the kings in the southern kingdom, write down the prophets who ministered in the northern kingdom, write down the prophets who ministered in the southern kingdom, and timelines and all that. And then when I began to study it, it all made sense. So God is sending prophets to northern, southern, and in a few places he rebukes them, few places he's encouraging them. And so the Old Testament started to make sense. So the spirit of wisdom will bring anointing upon us to understand not only scriptures or the Bible and when we're studying, but also to, bring forth wisdom in your workplace, wisdom to deal with your managers, with bosses who are rude, right? I'm sure you've heard of this saying, knowledge speaks, but wisdom listens. The Holy Spirit imparts the mind of the Lord to us. So welcome him in your life. Speak to him. Seek his guidance. Ask him for wisdom. Listen to what the Holy Spirit is revealing in your spirit. Right? You may be in your workplace. Suddenly the Holy Spirit may give you an idea. Now the wrong thing to do is to go and tell everybody about that idea. Keep it with you. Think about it, work on it. Now, the Lord gives you an idea. Don't just immediately pounce on it, but stay on it. Let it make root. Let it get shape. And then you begin to, you can talk to your bosses, or you can talk if you are starting something on your own. Start small. But the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of wisdom will anoint you. There is anointing in artistic and creative skills. This is wonderful, Bezalel, and how God so wonderfully gave wisdom to this young, to two young men. And what they had to do was to come up with an attire for the high priest. Let's read Exodus chapter 31, 1 to 6. Exodus 31, 1 to 6. Yes, anyone?
I'll read that.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "See, I have called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God, in wisdom, in understanding, in knowledge, and in all manner of workmanship, to design artistic works, to work in gold, in silver, and in bronze, in cutting jewels of settings, carving woods, and to work in all manner of workmanship. And indeed, I have appointed him with Ahabel, son of Abishab, of the tribe of Dan, and I have put wisdom in his heart, all the gifted artisans, that they may make all that I have commanded you." Thank you. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Kennedy. Amen. Thank you. So we see here in Exodus, God is, he said, he appointed Bezalel, and he tells Moses that I have appointed him and I've anointed him to do what? Cutting jewels, carving wood, and all kinds of workmanship, right? And he also chooses Eholiab from the tribe of Dan. And I have put wisdom in their heart, in his heart, to do what? To make artisans, to make basically what they did was they also carved out, you know, made embroideries. And if you read Exodus, they made wonderful material for the high priest to wear, put the right stones in the right place. It's wonderful. Now, who gave that wisdom? God is saying, I chose Bezalel and Oholiab and the team under them, and that they may all do what I have commanded them to do. These men were designated by God for a specific purpose, right? To do what? To do artistic works. The Spirit of God imparted to them was enough for them to do the work that is assigned. So picture this. Probably Bezalel woke up in the morning and he said, the spirit of wisdom is upon him. And he says, okay, let us make, you know, just an example, right? Let us make a wonderful, you know, a dress for the high priest. So he says, okay, how do we do this? They came up with the ideas, he and his team. Now, Bezalel didn't go and say, the Holy Spirit has anointed me with full of wisdom, and so this is why I'm doing this. He didn't do all that, right? He probably didn't realize it was just something that God put in him, right? The spirit of wisdom. Maybe it was a, you know, some thought just came into his mind and he was able to work on it and then come up with this craftsmanship and fulfill. Finally, what he did, what, you know, what he was interested in, it was through the wisdom of God. Right? The task was achieved. That even after receiving the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom, they had to follow it up with work. Remember that God has given us the spirit of wisdom, but we have to follow it up with work. We have to do something about it. Don't let our, you know, the wisdom that God is giving us, don't let it become stagnant. Now, when it becomes stagnant, there's no innovation, there's no creativity. Right? Just a couple of days ago, I was reading about Israel and Russia and China, and I love to read those, you know, what's happening in world events, because we know that these are some of the nations involved in the second coming and things to happen in the future. And so I love to read these things, right? What's happening in Israel? What do they do? And other things, other nations as well. So why is that? Because we need to ask God. God, sometimes we know, you know, we know everything from the scriptures and we feel, okay, there's nothing new that's coming. No. The spirit of wisdom, when God gives us, he will bring out new revelations, new ideas, new strategies. And that's, here's the thing. We need to work on it, right? So if God gives you the wisdom to start a small ministry, catering to a certain group of people, that's wonderful, but you need to follow up with work. We need to do something about it, right? Don't just identify a problem, but bring the solution. Now, we won't read this entire chapter on Genesis 41, but we all know this story, right? When the king has a dream, and in the dream, there were 7 weak cows that eat up the 7 healthy cows. And the king was distressed. He said, what kind of dream is this? And somehow the news goes out and Joseph is brought in front of the king. Now, Joseph is, you know, filled with God's power, God's wisdom. God has anointed him. He was a chosen one among all his brothers. And Joseph, what does he do? Not only interprets the dream, but he also tells the king, or the Pharaoh, king, this is what your dream meant. This is what is going to happen in the next 14 years in the nation of Egypt. 7 years, there will be plenty. 7 years, there will be famine. So this is what your dream means. Now, God also gave Joseph the wisdom. He didn't say, okay, this is your dream. And then he said, okay, can I go back now? No. He said, Pharaoh, I can give you a solution for this problem. With the 7 years of plenty, we'll store up barns. We will store up, and then for the 7 years of famine, we will not suffer because we would have stored up for the next 7 years. He had the ability to foresee what was ahead. Now, just imagine this. What if Joseph said, okay, 7 years is plenty, 7 years is famine. That's it. What would have happened? The king would have said, okay, give him a reward, send him back to the prison. Probably that would have happened. But Joseph just didn't identify the problem. He came up with a solution. And after giving that wonderful solution, the Pharaoh says, who better than the man himself who came up with the idea? He is better to handle the whole thing. Because he foresaw what can be done. And in a moment, Joseph, who was a prisoner, became second in command in the entire nation of Egypt. Just a moment, maybe 3 or 4 minutes of conversation. 5 minutes of conversation. In 5 minutes, the person who was in prison, held captive, became second in command in Egypt. Why? Because the wisdom that God gave him, he didn't just identify, but he solved the problem. He came up with a solution. Now, in our workplace, sometimes we may not be able to come up with a solution immediately, like how Joseph did. But we can continue to ask the Lord, Lord, grant me wisdom. How do I? Now, this is the problem. I know that you have a solution. I know that there's a way out of this. But give me the wisdom. Help me to understand. Anoint me with your spirit so that I can foresee what things are ahead. Right? Now, in ministry, there will be times when people may cause confusions, there may be strifes, there may be things happening within a church. As a leader or as a pastor, you need the wisdom of God to handle those. You need to foresee what is ahead. Remember yesterday we brought up this point that, we need to, the team is always above the individual. So the same way, the ministry is above the individual. Right, so how to make decisions, how to tap into the working of the Holy Spirit. He will definitely give you ideas. Right, let me share this. When we came to Bangalore, we did a youth concert. And then we did the youth concert. Many students, all of them came. And we shared the gospel. There were 2-3 of them who gave their lives to Christ. But later on, after a year or so, I realized that, especially in the city of Bangalore, it's wiser to do things in a smaller way than to, do big concerts. Because we see that follow-up and, the work after that, we were not seeing any fruit, right? Of course, for the concert, youth concert, they would come. Lives were touched, but we were not seeing people coming into the church. So I remember, praying, and the Lord gave me this idea. Do things in a small way in the city and repeat it, right? So then we came up with something called as worship evenings, right? So 5 to 7 on a Friday or a Saturday, and it was a repetitive thing. So what we would do, we'd go out, give out invites. We tell them, okay, every second Saturday we have worship evening. Why don't you come? Then we saw many students coming. We saw that, in smaller settings, they were more comfortable. They were more comfortable to come and be part of the worship evenings. And slowly, a lot of students started adding into the church. Now, how did this idea come up? God put it in our heart, right? It is the Spirit of God who gives wisdom, right? Step out to think and act in unfamiliar territory. Now, there will be times when God will ask us to step out in unfamiliar territory. Let's read 1 Chronicles chapter 28, 10 to 12, and verse 19. 1 Chronicles 28, verses 10 to 12, and the verse 19.
Sir, shall I read it?
No.
Look sharp now, God has chosen you to build his house, holy house. Be brave, determined, and do it. Then David presented his son Solomon with the plans for the temple complex, porch, storerooms, meeting rooms, and the place for atoning sacrifice. He turned over the plans for everything that God's Spirit had brought to his mind, the design of the courtyards, the arrangements of rooms, and the closets for storing all the holy things. Here are the blueprints for the whole project as God gave me to understand it, David said. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Rupa. So this is a wonderful example now, see, of stepping out into unfamiliar territory. What was David? He was a shepherd boy. He was a strong boy. He could fight. He was not afraid, right? He was his territory was more of, you know, you could say outdoors, right? He was, as a young boy, he was always outdoors. He killed the lion. He killed the bear. He was more of an outdoor person than indoors, right? And this was unfamiliar territory for David. What this whole thing of, you know, buildings, architecture, design, measurements, very unfamiliar territory to David. But here's what he says. Here are the blueprints for the whole project as God gave me to understand. So David is, you know, advanced in age, and he says, he calls Solomon and he says, Solomon, you have a task ahead of you. The task is you got to build a good temple, right? A wonderful, nice temple, beautiful temple, the best, give the best to God. And he and David gives Solomon the blueprints of what, you know, of the whole design. He says, this is where the temple complex should be. This is where the Levites' rooms and the priests will be. These are the entire thing. And David gives it to Solomon. And David says, this is what God gave me. The Spirit of God gave David the exact measurements, the specifications, which room should be where, how the temple courtyard should look, how big they should be, how what area, what size, everything God gave David the wisdom. Now, all of this was unfamiliar ground to David. Right now, what are we trying to bring out? Sometimes we are very comfortable doing things that we know, right? But we need to step out into unfamiliar territory, right? Part of this is receiving ideas from the Holy Spirit, right? We can be comfortable in doing things that we are strong in doing, right? Probably if you told David, can you please go and there's an army there waiting, they're coming against us, can we go? David would have said, yeah, he would have been full of confidence. But if you had told David, can we build a temple, they would have said, okay, I'm not really sure about measurements and these things, I'm not an architect, or I'm not too sure about design and all of it. But God gave him the wisdom, right? Gave him the, you know, God also mentions, when you read how David came up with the whole plan, and everything that Solomon did was David's, was from David's plan. God also tells David how much gold to use, how much silver to use, and how many precious stones, and everything. How the tabernacle should be, what kind of material of cloth should be placed. In the tabernacle, you see that they have carpets down, right? And so what kind of material that should be, everything was, explained by God. Everything was through the Spirit of wisdom. So what is it that we can learn? God can take us to unfamiliar territories, right? So for example, maybe some of us may not be comfortable with computers. Just an example, right? Maybe somebody is not familiar with computers. Now, God may give us a job where you have to work only on the computer, right? And then he makes us do things so that he can show that, you know, my spirit will give you wisdom. Because if we already know how to do it, we may depend on our own strength. We don't need the Holy Spirit then. Then we say, I did this. Right? But if we are step into territories that we are unfamiliar with, immediately we will look to God. Right? You know, growing up as a young boy, I hated hospitals. The very smell of hospitals would make me nauseous, and I didn't like going into hospitals. That is something I just didn't want to do. You know, sometimes I would see a hospital, just turn away from it because I didn't like to see it. You know, I had this negative feeling towards hospitals. Then the moment I got into the pastoral team, I got into the team called member care. Now in member care, my job was to go for house visit and hospital visits. So what I didn't like most, I would go with such, say, God, not hospitals. House visit is okay, but not hospitals. And you go there, and you know there. You and so for the first 3 odd years, I'd go into ICUs, and it was really God putting me into an unfamiliar territory. But praise God, because I've overcome that feeling, you know, and I know that God gives us the strength, God gives us the wisdom to handle these seasons that he takes us through. So don't be afraid of stepping into unfamiliar territory. Look to God. Enhance your knowledge, understanding, and skill. Daniel chapter 1 verse 17. Yes, could one of us please read that? Daniel 1 17.
Daniel 1:17. As for these four young men, God gave them knowledge and skill in all literature and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Amen.
Amen. Yes. So Daniel and his friends had come from an exile from a foreign land, right? They have been selected among the young men. They were trained. They were taught about the ways of Babylon, about literature, about language, about culture. And while they were working there, God stepped into their situation, and they learned the language, they learned the culture, they learned what the Babylonians are, what they do. And Daniel 5:14 says, this is later on, as Daniel is matured and he has spent time with the king. The king said to Daniel, I've heard about you, right? This is many years later. I've heard about you that you're full of the Holy Spirit, that you've got a brilliant mind, that you are incredibly wise. Right? The king is saying, Daniel, I've heard that you were full of the Holy Spirit. You've got a brilliant mind and you're incredibly wise. These are people who the Jews who were taken into Babylon, they learned the language, they learned the culture, they learned the literature of Babylon, and God stepped in. They excelled in what they were doing. They acquired knowledge, they acquired understanding, skill. They excelled in that many years later, the king is saying, later on, the king says, I've heard about you. I've heard that the nation of Babylon was successful because you were governing that nation. So Daniel, you continue to do this. I want you to be the governor of Babylon. So enhancing and acquiring skills and knowledge is very important in terms of innovation and creativity. Right? Just because I want to innovate something, I can't just stay on territory which I already know, right, which I'm already strong in. God can make us to step out, gain knowledge, gain skill, gain understanding, and then give us ideas and strategies. Right? Proverbs 19:8 says, do yourself a favor and learn all you can. Then remember what you learn and you will prosper. So even as each one of us here are join the Bible College and you're learning. What are you doing? You're enhancing your knowledge. You may know, we all know about the scriptures, but what are we doing? We're enhancing our knowledge. We're enhancing our understanding and skills. And God will begin to step in and work in our lives. He will bring innovation. He will bring creativity, discovery. He will bring inspiration into our hearts. Right. So I'm just trying to translate this even into ministry, but this same thing can be applied in the workplace as well, right? Where we can say in your families as well, right? We need the wisdom of God, right? To handle family situations, to handle family, children, everything. We need the wisdom of God. And so when we enhance our knowledge, enhance our skills, God steps in and he brings innovation. Last point, use your imagination and train your memory. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. 7, sorry. 2 Timothy 1, verse 7. Could one of us please read that? 2 Timothy 1 and verse 7.
For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind. Amen.
Man, thank you, Prabhakar. So God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and sound mind. I was reading this wonderful article and it said, the heading of the article was very catchy. It said, the greatest nation is our imagination. Right? The greatest nation is our imagination. Our imagination can take us to many places. Right? And so God is the one who has given us the spirit of, given us this mind, and he has given us imagination. Now, imagination can go the right way and the wrong way. But when we, use our imagination to the things of God, God can bring out so much for us, right? For example, just a simple example. Say you're reading the scriptures, right? I used to read the scriptures and fall asleep in between because it was like, oh, what do I do? I mean, there's so much to try and understand. But then I realized that, hey, God can help me understand the scriptures in a better way, right? So I started to use my imagination. So I would, this is just an example, right? You don't have to do it. This is something that's helped me. I would think of a scenario that happened in probably Old or New Testament. I would start imagining it. So picture this, the Lord Jesus is on the mountain. So I begin to imagine, he's on the mountain. There are thousands of people sitting there. There's no speakers, there's no mic, nothing, but he's preaching. Everyone can hear him. I don't know how, but everyone can hear him. So it's all, I'm imagining the whole thing. Then it's hot. Israel is a hot nation. Most of the times it's hot. So it's hot, peak hours in the afternoon. People are hungry. There's 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Right, so you just imagine that. 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Jesus is telling his disciples, get that. And so when we read it, when we're just reading it, he said, bring the 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. He took it, he gave thanks. We're just reading it. But the moment you imagine it and you think about it, it becomes it becomes such a revelation in our hearts. So 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, he fed thousands of people. How did the fish multiply? How did the 5 loaves become thousands of loaves? How did that happen? Did it just pop out of the boxes? And then we begin to wonder how God, Romans 3:17, calls those things that are not there as if they are there. 5 loaves, 2 bread. 5 loaves of bread, 2 fish. He called forth things. And it happened. So imagination is wonderful. It'll help you bring memory, right? It will train your mind. Every time I go through the book of Daniel and I think of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, it's like a story. The whole book of Daniel is a story. You know, it's like a movie that just keeps going. And so anytime we are reading it, it's just, okay, this is what God did. Even Apostle Paul, when you think about the missionary journeys, not just reading it, okay, he went here, he went there, but, you know, you're imagining it. There was no aircrafts. There were no, vehicles where he could just, you know, ride and go or drive around and give the do the ministry. No, no, no. It was so difficult. There were ships that he had to go to. He was shipwrecked many times. Without food, he was beaten. And so you picture the man, Apostle Paul. He says, I bear on my body the marks of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so when you imagine, use your imagination and read the scriptures, it becomes very powerful. The same way, when we use our imagination in our work, in our in our business, in our teams, as we use our imagination, train our memory, God is able to, you know, bring all kinds of ideas and strategies. He will develop our mental faculties that he has given us. So very important. I feel, I mean, something that has really helped me is, if I'm reading the scriptures or I'm doing anything else, use your imagination. See yourself, you know. I remember, I'll close with this. In Bangalore, we were about 7-8 people. I've shared this. There was this one time I put 50 chairs in the church, and the church people, you know, 10 of them came, 8 or 10 of them, and they said, why is all the chairs? I said, one day it's going to be filled. So let's put it. Let's look ahead. The 50 chairs were put in. They were not too keen on what was happening. But eventually we reached, we surpassed 50 as well. So using imagination is very important. Train your memory. Train your memory through scriptures and say, this is what the Bible teaches. And then God is able to, by his Holy Spirit, by the Spirit of wisdom, bring forth, greater ideas. He's able to bring forth, enhance your knowledge. He's able to bring forth innovation, creativity in every area of our lives. Right. So let's stop here. We completed this chapter. Next week, we'll get into chapter 8. And any thoughts, any questions? Any questions? Anyone like to share anything? Or we can close in prayer. Okay. All right. I hope everyone is able to, you know, receive the teachings, and I hope it's, you're able to track along. Okay, let's close in prayer. Rupa, is it okay if you can close in prayer for us?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, God, for your presence in our midst this morning. Thank you for the Father scriptures and the learning you have offered us this morning through your servant. We thank and praise you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for enabling us, Father God, to receive, that we may venture into new areas of life with your guidance and your enabling, Lord, anointing over our lives. We thank and praise you. As a class, Father, we want to commit ourselves, submit ourselves to your loving hands. Lord God, guide us and empower us to do all that you want us to do in our lives, that we may fulfill your purpose for our lives and for the generation you have placed us with. We thank and praise you, Lord. We praise you. We thank you for Pastor Paul. Bless him and his family, Father, and use him strong and mightily in that place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank amen. You, thank you. Thank you, Rupa. Thank you, everyone, for joining.
Amen.
Have a great week ahead. Great week. God bless you all.
Thank you, Pastor. God bless you too.
God bless. God bless. Bye.